Hey friends, welcome back to the channel. If you're watching this video, you're probably already aware of YouTuber Ali Abdaal and his retrospective timetable idea, which completely changes the way you revise. Yet, I've used this timetable for over 2 years now, and I've come up with ways to make it the ultimate revision timetable. So if you want to supercharge your learning, supercharge your revision, then continue watching. So the first tip I have for you when it comes to the retrospective revision timetable, that is to not forget the ultimate purpose of it. So what exactly is the ultimate purpose of the retrospective revision timetable? The ultimate purpose is basically deliberate practice to make you study as efficiently as possible by increasing the time on the concepts you find difficult and decreasing the time you spend on the concepts you find easy. Remember, the timetable is just a tool to identify these weak areas and these strong areas. So don't waste your time filling in the cells like how Ali Abdaal does in his own video. Just use a simple ranking system and put in numbers beside the dates, such as 1 to 5 or 1 to 10. Doing this has twofold advantages. The first one is that you aren't wasting time by constantly filling in colors, which becomes extremely tedious over the long run. The second advantage is that with a numerical scale, you've got way more nuance in the way you approach each topic. No longer is it just a choice between three, red, amber, and green, but instead it's a choice between 1, which is the weakest, and 5, which is the easiest, which you probably don't want to revise anymore. Now about organizing the timetable. You see, you may be tempted to have one retrospective revision timetable per exam you've got, whether it's a small exam or a large exam or whatever it is. But in my view, you should only have one timetable, and let's call that the master retrospective timetable. In this, you keep adding material and keep removing material as the year goes on. Another thing to consider while organizing your timetable is to make it as general as possible. So this is what Ali Abdaal refers to as the magic of categorization. Instead of having every single topic from the syllabus guide, just clump them all together. So suppose you've got monopoly power, you've got monopoly, you've got perfect competition, you've got monopolistic competition, all these various market structures in theory of the firm in economics. You just clump them all together into theory of the firm. That brings me to my next point, which is the timetable is not set in stone. You can keep it moving, keep altering it, keep consolidating it as you revise and master the content. When I first began studying economics with this retrospective timetable, I copied everything from the economics subject guide into the timetable. Over time, I realized that this was a horrible idea. And then I began to consolidate it. So I turned perhaps 5 topics into just 1. And I just kept doing this for all subjects. Another key extension of the concept that the timetable is not set in stone is to remember that at a certain point, you may master content to such an extent that you don't need to revise it anymore. I don't know about you, but this happened to me quite often with mathematics. I would find that I've already mastered the algebra, so I don't need to revise that again. Revising it again would be just a waste of time. So when the time comes, I'm focusing on the most difficult aspects, and I'm not thinking at all about algebra or trigonometry, which I can do with my eyes closed. Now, a key point to note is the retrospective revision timetable is useless if you don't update it on a daily basis. However, if you were to update it after every study session, that would quickly become really tedious, especially over the long run, not to mention highly inefficient. So the solution is to batch all your updates right into one section at the end of the day. Just in one shot, update everything that you've done right at the end of the day. This will help you save a whole lot of time and also allow you to engage in a lot of that deep work which is required for intense revision and, needless to say, really effective revision. Of course, updating your retrospective revision timetable also means you have to remove all that old stuff clogging it up, such as the past dates. Say you find one subject or one topic which you have to continuously revise. For me, that was redox reactions in chemistry. I would end up with one row that is 8 cells long. All I need to know is that the last time I studied it, it was terrible. I marked it as a 1 out of 10 or a 2 out of 10. In this case, you should delete all the old unnecessary cells in one go and leave only the past one remaining to maintain your own sanity and also to make it easier to find what you need to study next. Now, my next tip is how to be more specific while writing the revision timetable. Because let's face it, all these tips makes it more general, but sometimes you want to be more specific. My solution to this is to write down where you're exactly struggling every time you put the date into your revision timetable. So let's say in redox reactions, you can't figure out how to balance the thing. So you make a specific entry when you put the date in. You say that the specific problem is balancing the redox reaction. That way, the next time you study, it will become far easier to identify and actively work on that one spot which is extremely difficult for you. Now, this tip is about expanding the retrospective revision timetable, making it a super organizer for crazy effective revision. What I mean by this is that you put all the stuff for your revision into the timetable, not notes, mind you, the other important stuff. Say you've got a target for a paper, say you've got to score 40 on 50 in geography or something like that. Then you put that into the timetable. Suppose you have to practice a skill. This is especially important in English, in French, in other subjects where there's not that much to know, but you have to demonstrate some skill. Well, you can actually track that in the retrospective revision timetable. For me, I felt that I was really bad at English paper 1. So I made a note of that in my retrospective revision timetable. Another thing you could do is keep track of past papers. Just create another sheet and put those in, and you can track your progress over time. Now, this last tip involves actually extending this revision timetable to learning as well. What do I mean by this? You essentially take Ali Abdaal's concept and you merge it with Simon Clark's concept of a revision journal. So say today you couldn't get Monopoly Power. No problem. You mark tomorrow as the day when you have to study Monopoly Power again. If tomorrow you can get it, say it's a 9 on 10 or a 8 on 10, you mark another day 3 days from now. So that way you're getting some spaced repetition in. Say you can get it in 3 days, that's great. Mark it in a week from now, then mark it in a month from now, and it should be into your long-term memory by then. So your revision turns out to be more like, first, I have to practice what is planned for today. Then I look at the weak remaining areas and I revise those. So you see, we have combined two concepts together. One is spaced repetition and the other is deliberate practice to continuously increase the efficiency of that revision. So there you have it, guys. That is how to make the ultimate retrospective revision timetable. If you like this video, then be sure to give it a thumbs up and share it with your friends and perhaps even leave a comment. Whatever you do, don't forget to subscribe. All credit belongs to Ali Abdaal for the idea behind this revision timetable, which honestly changed my life, and I hope with my tips, it will make your revision the most efficient you've ever had. Ali, if you're watching this, I am very much inspired and I thank you for everything you've done.